All right, you're welcome. That'll be stuck in your head for the rest of the day. So that's great. Hey, my name's Paul. I'm glad you decided to join us today. We're picking up right where we left off because what we're talking about when we're talking about emotions is emotions have a place in our life. They're created by God and we want them in the car. We just can't give them the keys to the car. We don't want emotions to drive your life. We don't want you to be like a robot either, and we don't want you to wear your emotions on your sleeve. And there is this place where we're trying to explore and try to find out where we can kind of have and give emotions their place without letting it running our life. So today I want to talk about anger, and before we get into that, I just want to kind of affirm a couple things so that we're all on the same page. First thing is we all know how to act right, correct? If I were to say, do you know how to act right? I heard a coach this week say, you got to act right. And I was like, well, I'm assuming everybody knows how to act right, right? So we'll start with sports. Let me give you a little quiz. If you're at a game and a referee makes a bad call, you should what?
Let him know.
Let him know. I agree. Let them know. For those of you online, we're getting answers from the audience here today. All right. So if you have a child and they spill a drink at the table for the fifth time in the week, you should. Yeah. Right. When you get in the car and somebody else has driven it before you have, and there's less than an eighth of a tank in it, you should. Right. We all know how to act. If you're driving in your car and the light turns green and someone in front of you is clearly on their phone, you should, right? If you decide to scroll through social media and you're reading posts and then you start reading comments and that becomes addicting, and so you kind of read that for a while and somebody is clearly just a moron, you should what? And so here's what we want to explore today. I think we all know how to act. We all know what we should do, right? I hope. We all know that there are certain times that we should keep our mouth shut. There's certain times that we should say something in gentleness. There's something that we should do about this when we disagree and there's these kinds of things. We all know how to act. We all know how to act right. The trouble is it's rarely our actions that get us into trouble, isn't it? It's our reactions. And so we could talk about our actions all day long, and we could really say, and if this happens, you should do this, and if this, we could create a graph and a chart and color-code it. If this happens, you do this. But that's not how our life works at all, is it? It's not our actions that get into trouble. It's our reactions. It's our reactions that begins to cause problems. And so this is the part that Jesus wants to get a hold of when we talk to emotions, because he begins to explain this so clearly, and I think it's going to become clear really early on here today about what we're talking about, because I know how to act, but react tells more about me than I really want people to know about the condition of my heart. Listen to what Jesus says in Matthew chapter 12. Matthew chapter 12, verse 33. And he's using an analogy here. So instead of tree, you can just insert my life, all right? So this is what he says. Make a tree good and its fruit will be good. Or make a tree bad and its fruit will be bad. Jesus is really deep here right now. I hope you're tracking along with us here. He says, for a tree is recognized by its fruit. Then he's upset about some things that were said by some of the religious people who all knew how to act right, but their reactions were terrible. They all knew the right answers. They all knew God's laws. They knew everything. They knew how to act right, but their reactions were just horrible. And he tells them, he says, you brood of vipers. I mean, you're just like a whole slew of vipers. How can you who are evil say anything good? And then Jesus outs all of us when he says this, because you think that you can act right and think your way into situations. He goes, but that's not how it works. He goes, look. It's out of your heart. It's out of your heart that your mouth speaks. The mouth speaks what the heart is full of. And so if you're angry all the time, it's because you have a heart issue. And you go, no, I just wasn't thinking. I'll never do that again. I'll think better next time. I'll think. Jesus goes, you don't have a thinking problem. You already know the right answer. You already know you shouldn't have done that. You have a much bigger problem that needs to be attended to. And if you're just trying to filter, have a better filter to not respond and react in certain ways, he goes, that filter's not going to work because it's not a filter issue. It's a heart issue because your heart is filled with something, and that's what is coming out your mouth. Verse 35. So a good man, this is what a good man or woman, a good man brings good things out of the good stored in him. And an evil man brings evil things out of the evil stored up in them. To which I'm sure somebody was like, are you saying I'm evil, Jesus? Because my mama said I was a good boy. Well, I'm not saying you're evil. I'm just saying that when the pressure of life comes on, your reactions are different than what you say they are. He says, so I'll tell you, everyone who will have to give an account on the day of judgment for every empty word they have spoken, for by your words you're going to be judged, be acquitted. And by your words you will be condemned. And everybody went, but I know how to act, right? But that's not how you act. So, do you know anybody who's angry right now? And if you don't know anybody who's angry, go to Facebook or Twitter. You'll find somebody. It's not hard to do, right? You'll find somebody, right? I don't know what we're all angry about today, but I'm sure it's something. We'll find out later what it is. Because right now, everything is politicized, sports, school, churches, open. I mean, all these kinds of things. We don't have an agenda here today. What we want to talk about is it a sin to be angry, right? No, it's not. Being angry isn't a sin. But the problem is often our anger leads us into destructive behavior. How do we do that? Ephesians, the Apostle Paul writes this in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 26. He says, in your anger, he says, you're gonna be angry, but in your anger, don't sin. It's not a sin to be angry. But when you are angry, make sure you don't sin. And don't let the sun go down while you are still angry. Don't try to go to sleep when you are angry. And do not give the devil a foothold. A foothold in what? Don't give the devil a place, room. Don't give the devil space or access to your friendships, to your workplace, to your marriage, to your parenting. Don't allow the devil to have a foothold there. Now, we have a little bit of a problem with angry. Not only is it an emotion created by God, right, which is weird. Why would God create an emotion that often kind of gets us into trouble? Why would that happen? We have a bigger problem with this issue of anger is because Jesus gets angry. And so how do we begin to kind of deal with this? Because, you know, you could say, hey, you shouldn't, in your anger, don't sin. And you go, yeah, but Jesus, I mean, he was flipping stuff in the temple and all this. And we're going to get to that in a second. Because Jesus gets angry in the temple, and it's because he's angry at hypocrisy, he's angry at inflation, he's angry at greed, abuse, misuse of the Father's house. And so we begin to see him coming into the temple where they're selling, and you had to buy your animal to sacrifice, and you can get it for like 4 pence outside, and it's like 75 on the inside, and the inflation and the markup, so people could just kind of pocket it, is what made Jesus angry. So I'm going to look at this real quick. Matthew chapter 21, verse 12 is where we're gonna take off right here and begin to look at this. So Jesus enters into the temple courts, and he drives out all the people there who are basically taking advantage of everyone buying and selling there. And like, well, if you can't really sacrifice, you can't have your sins canceled unless you buy this one. There's a huge markup. It's a huge cost for this. And so he sees this taking place, and he overturned the tables of money. Not only does he overturn the tables of money changers and the benches. So he's flipping tables, flipping benches of those, selling doves at a highly inflated rate. So if you're angry at inflation right now, what would Jesus do, right? He says, look. It is written, he said to them, my house will be called a house of prayer. And you have turned this into the house of inflation. And you're stealing from people. You're price gouging sacrificial animals. You're price gouging. And he goes, the blind and the lame came to him, and then they were healed. And so Jesus is, this is an interesting thing, because not only is he like, I'm mad at you, he also has a physical like, flips a table, flips some benches. And it's ironic because Jesus is known for his love. He's not known for his Anger. We don't say, hey, I want you to love like Jesus, and then also I want you to be angry and, you know, flip a table today, right? Because Jesus loved the outcast. He loved and he touched lepers. He forgave sinners. And we're not trying to inspire you today to go home and flip over your kitchen table, right? But he never got angry. I just want to pause here for a second. Jesus never got angry when someone criticized him. He never got angry when someone violated his rights, and they did. He never got angry when someone disagreed with his views, and they did. He never posted something he didn't like or didn't agree with, namely because he didn't have social media, but B, because he wouldn't do this. Jesus got angry when people who were hurting didn't have access to his heavenly Father. The other thing I'd like to point out is Jesus got angry and he flipped tables. He didn't flip people. He flipped tables. He didn't flip people. What do you mean? Well, he didn't flip them off. Oh. He didn't punch. He didn't cuss anybody out. He flipped a table. He never flipped a person. Because the table represented the and supported the hypocrisy and the mistreatment of others. So I get it. So many people, in their effort to be right, have forgotten to be loving. I don't know if you remember a couple years ago, back in 2020. Do you remember back in 2020? There was this thing called a pandemic. You remember that? I remember there was people that were angry at me. I had some people that were angry at me that GP, because we opened our doors back up, that we were reckless and put people's lives in unnecessary risk, and they were angry. And then I had people that were mad that we closed for a season because we were, I was told I was caving to the liberal agenda by wearing a mask. And I remember both sides, and I was like, well, gosh, this is a fun place to be. I just got smashed in the middle, but regularly on both sides. And both sides felt righteously right. Righteously right. And I think sometimes in our effort to be right, we've forgotten to be loving. And so does Jesus get angry? Yeah, he gets angry. Is it really bad to get angry? Well, that's complex, right? It's complex. And this is going to get a little bit complex this morning because the Bible says that God burns with anger, so we got that going on with us. And the Bible says that we should fear the day of the Lord. Yet the Apostle Paul, in both Galatians and Corinthians, warns us against having fits of anger and wrath. And most of what the Bible says about anger is negative. And yet it's a clear human emotion, and it's a part of our life, and everybody in here has been angry. Everyone of us in here has reacted in a way that we wished we hadn't have done. We've said things we wish we hadn't have said. And yet it can be sinful, it can be excessive, it can be abusive, and it can be misdirected. And then we have James, Jesus' own brother, who writes down that that anger does not produce God's righteousness. So why? And what do we do with this? I mean, how can anger be in the car without giving the keys to the car? And many of us would probably say that we don't give anger the car, you know, the car keys for long. It's just a moment, right? Something washes over us. We lose our mind. We react. We apologize, rinse and repeat. And that's because anger has a way to make us blind. It pushes us away from being rational and responsible. In fact, there's actually a chemical released in your brain that shuts down the rational part of your mind so that you can just feel it. This is why some of you calm down 20 seconds. Some of you, your Daniel Tiger fans go, if you get so mad and you want to roar, take a deep breath and count to four. And that does it, right? You're reset. Some of you, it takes a day or two. Some of you, a week. Some of you have been holding on to anger for years. 4 seconds didn't make a hill of beans difference for you. Others, it does. It's a very, very complex emotion, but when the chemicals of anger, I mean, sometimes it feels like rocket fuel up your spine and you can just feel it coming, right? You feel it. What actually does is it shuts down your ability to think rationally. And usually you'll go, I don't know what I was thinking. You're actually telling the truth. Now don't nudge somebody and be like, I told you. Not an excuse. And here's why. Anger loves to protect your ego. Anger loves to protect our ego. It's usually more concerned with our reputation than it is righteousness. And that's the trouble. It's a very complex emotion, and it's an odd emotion because it wells up with inside of us, and then it becomes visible, right? Our faces get red. Our hearts beat faster. Our blood pressure rises, and usually somebody looks at us and goes, are you angry? No, right? It's very hard to disguise when we're angry. Yeah, anger in favor of justice, according to Jesus, anger when fighting for a good cause is something that is a place for, but unfortunately, our anger is looking for a cause to fight for. You know people who if they're not in a fight, they're looking for a fight, right? That's not good. But when anger is good, it's motivated by love for others. And most of our anger is fueled by apathy, not love. And selfishness is what turns the fight dirty. Selfishness is what tells us, I want, or I need, or I didn't get, I don't get. And we can invent all kinds of rationalizations in the form of why we deserve what we deserve, what we want, when we want, and what others didn't give us, and what we're owed, and what we deserve, and what we're right, and why we need to act now. All under the banner of self-righteousness or protecting us, and anger can take us over by force. Now, the second way, besides clouding our judgment, is anger can get wrong in the way we express our frustration, and we can feel out of control, enraged, irrational. So anger comes in a variety of forms, and I just want to give you a couple. I'm going to give you six ways anger can spring up on you, and you may not have all six. You may live with somebody that has maybe four or five, or you may have one or two. Some of you have crockpot anger. Crockpot anger takes a while, right? Some of you don't fly off the handle. It steams inside of you for a while. And then, after a while, when the temperature reaches the right part, well, then somebody's going to pay. But it takes a long time to get there. Others of you have blaming anger, right? It's never your fault. It's always someone else's fault. You're always the victim, and there's always someone to blame. But it's never your fault. Some of you have resignation anger, which is when your self-esteem gets hurt or shot at. And you basically say, hurt you if you want me to, and use me if you want me to, and you can trample me under your foot because pain is better than feeling anything, and so you just kind of take it, and your anger makes you kind of feel alive. Some of you have a subtle controlling anger. Like, I'll never let anybody do this to me again, so back off. It's just a presence you have about you. Some of you, and this one's tough, have random anger. Which is, I'm not responsible for what I say or do. No one cared when I got hurt, so why should I care when they got hurt? And usually these people have someone that travel around with them and say this, if you really knew them the way that I know them, you would find out they're not that bad. That person has to have an enabler. An enabler that goes around and says, oh, if you just got to know them, they're really not that big, mean jerk that you think they are. Really? And who are you, the press secretary? What is this all about? Number six, powder keg anger. This is the Incredible Hulk. I dare you to push the button. And if you do, the Incredible Hulk comes out, and there you go. So anger can be in the car. We just can't let it drive the car. Because when it drives the car, it shuts down part of our brain, and we can't do that because responsibility and rationality begin to leave. And the Bible says, you know, help us when we get angry. It's going to happen. So if we're to say never get angry, that's not even a good goal to have. I'm never going to get angry again. Okay, well, you just lied. And you just lied. Just don't sin when you anger. Don't stay angry. Don't leave room for the devil to attack things that matter well to you in your anger. And I think anger is such a temptation for us is because it's deeply, deeply, deeply connected to our love of ourselves and our self-preservation, especially of our fear of being exposed or our need for security or right or justice or things aren't fair, right? When things aren't fair, it makes us angry. Watch a sporting event. If it's not fair, in your mind, what happens? And we can constantly feel the need to kind of bolster our fragile egos, right? And when our egos feel threatened, let's take one that nobody in this room has ever done, if you're a parent. When your kids don't listen, mine always do, but I'm sure, you know, yours probably don't. What happens? What happens when your kids don't listen? It damages your ego. And then we feel like we've lost control. And when we feel like we've lost control, we do what? We react. And anger puts on this big show of shock and awe, but it's often like a big cover-up because it overcompensates for our own perceived weaknesses and our own sense of vulnerabilities. And it's the exact opposite of the kind of freedom that we seek and strive for in our relationship with God. And anger reveals like our desire for control and getting our way. When we don't get our way, anger is right there to let us know this isn't right and this isn't fair. And it's easier to lash out at others than to express what's eating you on the inside. And the disappointment you feel, the frustration you have, because anger always wants control. Anger always wants control of the wheel. Anger always wants the keys. Because anger always assumes that it has the power to fix and to change things. So, what's the antidote? Excuse me. What's the antidote for anger? Gentleness. This week, I want you to kind of make a note and kind of watch yourself this week. So pretend like you videoed yourself. I send this out, so I... Right now I'm coaching U8 Dynamo Soccer. It's pretty intense, pretty intense. Actually, I say that, but youth softball this year was probably some of the craziest stuff I've seen ever as a parent, sport parent. But at U8, I send an email out earlier this year, and some of you are on the team and all that kind of stuff, and I'll say, hey, if you're struggling, videotape yourself on the sideline. Don't video the game. Video yourself. Watch it, play it back. Watch how you act during the week. So here's what I want you to do. Pretend like you're videotaping yourself this week. Videotape it, pretend it, and look at yourself objectively. Not the edited version of how we always view ourselves. And if somebody videoed your anger this week, would someone draw the same conclusion that you're acting out of a sense of justice? Or you're acting out of a sense of loss of control or damaged ego? After you analyze yourself, give yourself some strategies for timeouts. What do you mean, put yourself in timeout? Well, yeah. Confess that we live in a world of inflated egos and that we are fragile. I think having a sense of humor is something, and I don't mean sarcasm. I mean trying to laugh at yourself. Man, I struggle with that sometimes. I don't know about you, but I try to, like, be as perfect as possible, try to do the best that I can. I know how to act, I know how to do that, but then I don't, and then it's hard to laugh at yourself when you're embarrassed with yourself, isn't it? Well, let's try to do that this week. And I think it'll give us a greater capacity to accept grace, and I think we can join Jesus in what Jesus says in Matthew chapter 11. When Jesus gives us implications, when we were on vacation, I read a great book called Gentle and Lowly, and I think Jesus gives us a great insight into his heart when he says that inside my heart, out of my heart, Jesus says, out of my heart, my mouth speaks. And in Matthew, we get great insight into his heart when he says that I am gentle and humble in heart. Matthew 11:29. Gentle and humble. Humility and gentleness are rooted in love. But yes, he did respond to injustice. But I don't think we would say he was wrathful. So are we known for our gentleness? I don't know if I'm known for my gentleness. I don't think. Maybe in certain environments, people would say, oh, you're so gentle. I don't think the people that know me best would say, oh, man, he is just known for his gentleness. I can be gentle, but I don't think I'm known for it. And gentleness and humility get strength in trusting God's power and God's will for your life. And I don't know about you, but I need to grow in that even this week. So I just want us first to thank God that we do get angry about certain problems that exist in the world. I mean, I think we should be angry against racism. I think we should be angry and fight against what's going on with pornography. I think we should be angry and fight for our marriages, fight for those who are at risk, fight for those who are being human trafficked, fight for those who, you know, need clean drinking water. Those are the things that are unjust that should cause us to be angry. But as we get angry about those things, let's not sin, let's act. Let's act. Because in a very divided world, the world needs a unified church. And I know that's next to impossible in 2022. But instead, in your anger, let's not sin. Let's turn the tables and love people and work on our reactions. We all know how to act right. Let's work on how we can react right.
Hey there, and thanks for joining us today online. If you loved what you experienced today and you're local to Kankakee County, we'd love to invite you back for our in-person worship services. You can visit gatheringpoint.church anytime for more information. We hope to see you soon.